Our text is taken from the Gospel of Matthew, the 26th chapter, the 56th verse. Then all the disciples forsook him and fled. When one evening I listened to the records of Bach's Passion according to St. Matthew, I was struck by text and music of this one line. Then all the disciples forsook him and fled. It anticipates the words of Jesus on the cross. My God, why hast thou forsaken me? He who is forsaken by all men feels forsaken by God. And indeed, all men left him, and those who were nearest to him fled farthest away from him. We ordinarily are not aware of this fact. We are used to imagine the crucifixion in terms of those beautiful pictures in which, besides his mother and other women, at least one disciple is present. The reality was different. They all fled, and some women dared to watch only from far. An unimaginable loneliness in the moments in which his life and his work were broken. What shall we think about the disciples? Our first reaction probably is the question, how could they forsake him, whom they had called the Messiah, the Christ, the bringer of the new age of the world, whom they had followed, having left everything for his sake. But my reaction was different when I heard the words and tones of the record. I admired the disciples, for it is they to whom we owe the words of our text. They did not hide their flight. They simply stated it in one short sentence, a sentence by which they are judged for all times. The gospel stories bring many judgments against the disciples. We hear that they, including his mother and his brothers, misunderstood him continuously, and that their misunderstanding increased his daily passion. We read that some of the most important amongst them made claims to receive exceptional glory and power in the world to come. We hear that Jesus reproached them because their zeal for him made them fanatical against those who did not follow him. And in the reports, whose last source is Peter himself, we read that Jesus had to call him Satan, because Peter tried to dissuade him from going to Jerusalem into his death. And we read in the same reports that Peter denied his discipleship in the hour of test. These reports are astonishing. They show what Jesus did to the disciples. He taught them to accept judgment and not to present themselves in a favorable light. Without accepting such judgment, they could not have been his disciples. And our Gospels would not be what they are if the disciples had suppressed the truth about their own profound weakness. The glory of the Christ and the misery of his followers would not be manifest in the records as it is now. And yet, even in the same records, the desire of men to cover up his ugliness makes itself felt. Later traditions in our Gospels try to smooth the hard and hurting edges of the original picture. One could not bear within the established congregations the fact that all the disciples fled, that none of them was a witness of the crucifixion and the death of the Master. One could not accept the fact that only far away in Galilee their flight was arrested by the appearance of him whom they left alone in the hour of his agony and despair. So later on, one said that Jesus himself had told them to go to Galilee. Their flight was not a real flight. And still later, one said that they did not flee at all, but remained in Jerusalem. From earliest times on, the church could not stand the judgment against itself, its past and its present. It tries to hide what the disciples openly admitted, that we all forsook him and fled. But this is the truth about all men, including the followers of Jesus, today as in all times. The flight from God starts in the moment in which we feel his presence. Such feeling can work in the dark, half-conscious regions of our being, unrecognized but effective in the restlessness of the child's asking and seeking, of the adolescent's doubts and despairs, of the adult's desires and struggles. God is present, but not as God. He is present as the unknown force in us that makes us restless. But in some moments he appears as God. The unknown force in us which caused our restlessness becomes manifest as the God in whose hands we are, who is our ultimate threat and our ultimate refuge. In such moments, It is as if we were arrested in our hidden flight. But it is not an arrest by brutal force. It is an arrest which has the character of a question. And we remain free to continue our flight. This is what happened to the disciples. They were powerfully arrested when Jesus first called them. But they remained free to flee again. And so they did when the hour of test came. And so it is about the church and all its members. They are arrested in their hidden flight and brought into the conscious presence of God, but they remain free to flee again. Not only as individual men, but also as bearers of the church, pushing the church itself upon the road to Galilee, driving it as far away as possible from the point where the eternal breaks into the temporal. Man is fleeing from God. He is fleeing from God even in the church, in the place in which we are supposed to be arrested by the presence of God. Even there, we are in flight from him. If the ultimate cuts into the life of a man, he tries to take cover in the preliminary. He flees from the attack of that which hit him with unconditional seriousness, running for a safe place. And there are many places which look as safe to us as Galilee looked for the fleeing disciples. Let us consider some of them. Perhaps most effective in providing safety from the threatening presence of God is in our time the work we are doing. This was not always so. The attitude of the ancient men towards work is well summed up in the curse God speaks over Adam. In the sweat of your face you shall eat bread. And in the words of the 90th Psalm about the short years of our life, yet their span is but toil and trouble. Later on, bodily labor, with its tool and its drudgery, was left to the slaves, serfs, or uneducated classes. And it was distinguished from creative work, the privilege of the few, based on leisure time. Medieval Christianity considered work as a discipline, especially in the monastic life. But in the last period of our history, work has become the all-dominating destiny of all of us, if not in reality, so in demand. It is everything, discipline, production, creation. The difference between labor and work is gone. The fact that it stands under a curse in biblical view is forgotten. It has become a religion in itself, the religion of modern industrial society. And it has all of us in its grip. Even if we were able to escape the punishment of starvation for not working, something within us would not permit an escape from the bondage to work. For most of us, it is both a necessity and a compulsion. And as such, it has become the favored way of our flight from God. And nothing seems to be safer than this way. We ourselves get out of it the satisfaction to have fulfilled our duty. We are praised by others and by ourselves for work well done. We are providing support for our family or care for its members. We overcome day by day the dangers of leisure, boredom, and disorder. We get a good conscience out of it. And as a cynical philosopher has said, the real end of it, a good sleep. And if we do that kind of work, which is called creative, we have an even higher satisfaction, the joy of bringing something new into being. If somebody tells us that this is not his way to flee from God, we should ask him, did you never draw a balance sheet of your whole being? And if you did it honestly and discovered many points on the negative side, did you not write then on the other side your work and gained a positive balance in this way? The Pharisean of today would boast before God not so much of his obedience to the law and of his religious exercises, as he would boast of his hard work and his disciplined, successful life. And he would also find sinners with whom he could compare himself favorably. For there is another way to flee from God, the way which promises to lead us into the abundance of life, and which keeps this promise to a great extent. It is not necessarily the way of the prodigal son in the parable of Jesus. It can be the acceptance of the fullness of life open to us by a searching mind and the driving power of love towards the greatness and beauty of creation. Such longing for life does not need to close our eyes to the tragedy within greatness, to the darkness within light, to the pain within pleasure, to the ugliness within beauty. Perhaps the life of all men would be more abundant if more men and women dared to experience the abundance of life. But this also can be a way of fleeing from God, just as a way of labor and work. In the ecstasy of living, the limits of the abundance of life are forgotten. I do not speak of the shallow methods of having a good time, of the desire for fun and entertainment. This is, in most cases, the other side of the flight from God under the cover of labor and work. It is called recreation and is justified by everybody as a means of better work. But I speak of the ecstasy of living, which includes participation in the highest and the lowest of life, in one and the same experience. And this demands courage and passion, but it also can be faith. flight from God. We should not be judged morally for it, but we should be made aware of the restlessness and the fear to encounter God. The man who is under the bondage of work should not boast against the man who loves the abundance of life. But he should not, the other one should not boast either against him who is in the bondage of work. Both are fleeing from God. There are many in our time who have experienced the limits of both ways, for whom successful work has become as meaningless as diving into the abundance of life. I am speaking of the skeptics and cynics, of those in anxiety and despair, of those who for a moment in their lives have been stopped in their flight from God and then continued, though in a new form, in the form of consciously questioning or denying him. Their attitude is very much described in our period by literature and the arts. They are considered as the true representatives of man's predicament. And somehow this is justified. If they are serious skeptics, their seriousness and the suffering falling from it justifies them. If they are desperately in despair, the hell of their seriousness and witness to it. They are edified by it. They are better than the disciples. But are they really? If the cross has become a tenet of our religious heritage, of parental and denominational traditions, is it then still the cross of the Christ, the decisive point in which the eternal cuts into the temporal? But perhaps it's not the paternal tradition which keeps us near the cross. Perhaps it's a sudden emotional experience, a conversion under the impact of a powerful preacher or evangelist that has brought us for the first time face to face with the cross. Even then, on the height of our emotion, we should ask ourselves, is our bow to the cross not the safest form of our flight from the cross? Or are we arrested, like the disciples in Galilee, honestly and lastingly? On each road of his flight from God, man can be stopped. God can arrest him. There are many ways in which this can happen, and there is no royal way. No church and no sect and no preacher has a royal way. As Paul was arrested by a blinding light and by questioning words, and Augustine by the voice of a child, and Luther by the flash of a lightning, so innumerable small or big experiences may stop our flight from God. But however they occur, they have one quality. They cut into the ordinary processes of life, into the bondage to our work, into the abundance of our life, into the despair of our heart, into the devotion of our soul. But whenever the eternal cuts into the temporal. It shakes and opens and disrupts the temporal. It is a hard experience to be arrested on one's flight from God. Some are in the bondage of their work, and something happens that throws them out of it, and it seems that the meaning of their life is gone. Or they are just in the midst of their work, and suddenly they realize that what they are producing soon will sink into the darkness of an utterly forgotten past. And they may even doubt about its value for today. They may realize in a flash of insight that most results of their work, which they have done so well, increases the amount of technical gadgets or intellectual sales goods, both of which have become a curse of our period. They are arrested, and perhaps in this moment, in which much is shaken and broken, also much may be opened in the depths of their world and in the depths of their souls. And they may hear a voice saying, "Why do you flee from me?" Some have dived into the abundance of life with its greatness and its tragedy. Their relation to life is not superficial. They know its negative sides, but they love it and cover their flight from God with their love of life. And then it may happen that an experience of a deep disappointment, which is neither great nor tragic, but which reveals the emptiness lying at the roots of life, may happen to them. Such an experience may be the way in which some are arrested in their flight from God. And in such moments, not only the vanity of all things, but also the fullness of that which shines through all things may appear, and they may see a light which is blinding and illuminating together. The disciples called it the light of resurrection. It may become a light of resurrection for those who are arrested in their flight into the abundance and vanity of life. Some have fallen into the state of doubt and despair. They do not even try to cover up their flight from God by work or life. They simply deny him. There is something surprising about them. They are most conscious in their flight from God, but in reality their flight is already stopped, not completely, but more than in those who are unbroken in their bondage of work and life. Despair can be both the last step away from God and the first step towards God. Only one thing can arrest them radically, that they realize in a shaking awareness the lack of ultimate seriousness in their doubt and despair, that they see the hidden arrogance and self-certainty in their cynicism. If they see this, they are arrested on their flight. And the hidden acceptance of truth, which had made even possible their doubt and despair, may become an overpowering light from which to flee there is no desire. Some have found the cover of their flight from God in their devotion to God. No cover can be safer than this, but God can arrest on their flight from him even those who use himself as a cover for their flight. He can show the futility of their religious work in many ways. He can break their confidence in even their most serious devotion and discipline. He can undercut their doctrinal certainty, their moral laws, their ritual traditions. He can confront religion with the secular world and show them that he is the God of both, and of the secular not less than of the religious. This was and is the way in which many great religious men were and are arrested by God. And they heard a voice saying to them, "Why don't you trust in me alone, instead of trusting in your religious discipline and knowledge and devotion? Why do you flee from me, using my name for your flight? Why do you flee from me? Let you be arrested by me. For there is in me meaning and abundance and truth, and an eternal yes over you. Accept this yes, end your flight.